Again for a moment. Have a seat again for a moment. We're not done. There's a reason why we kept the orchestra up here, and as we prepare even more of our minds for this particular message, we want to sing a couple of stanzas, the first and the last of 517. And we'll do it with a prayerful voice, almost humming voice, as you read these words inspired by Roald Palmer, that in the time of Easter, at the time of Christ, the whole thing in question was, do you believe? Your violin's ready?
Passover lamb. Oh, I paid $5 for that. Really?
How lucky were you? Well, last year I came by and I bought it in the sanctuary, and forget it, they stripped me dry. I couldn't even have the money to pay for my food. Those who were smart did that. But everywhere in Jerusalem there were throngs of people. Everybody with their little lamb. But what they did not anticipate was that God also had come that particular year, and his lamb was going to be slain that Friday. The best gift that God will ever have for humanity. God brought his lamb. Now, according to those that wanted Jesus dead, they did not want Jesus dead on Friday. That was not their plan. Their plan was to torture this man for at least 5 to 7 days. As you and I know, the crucifixion was a horrible tool of torture. In fact, it goes all the way back to the kingdom of Medes and Persia. You know how it was in those days. You've seen the movies. You've read a little bit of history. A new kingdom will come into your village or to your kingdom, and they will take people, they will rape the ladies, and they will do everything possible for you to have a miserable life. They will strip you naked, and they will then parade you from there all the way to their own kingdom for you to be offered as a sacrifice. And it was, in those days, anathema for somebody, once they entered the kingdom of the Medes and Persians, to die on their ground. So they had to invent ways to kill you in order for you not to touch the ground. Well, they started with one way. As you know, most of the cities had high walls. Very high walls. And they would just get the men, and they would put ropes around their shoulders, and then they would string these people over the wall. Can you imagine the pain of all those bones just dislodging out of place as you hung on the other side of the city wall to die of exposure as your skin crackled, the birds of the air came to eat you alive? That's how they started. Then, as Alexander the Great came in, he said, well, you know, I like the crucifixion issue. Yes, that is a good tool to deter people from being defiant. So we'll start crucifying people also. And that's how the crucifixion came to the Romans. In fact, somebody, when they were crucified, they were put in such a way that the agony that they had every single day was incredible, to the point that they had to give these men, especially men, there's no record of a woman being crucified, but these men, they would give them this spicy thing, gall and vinegar and oil and all kinds of things, so they can weather the pain. And that was a mistake, because as soon as they took that, you know, they felt a little bit better, so they continued to live one more day, or 3 more hours, or 4 more hours. As we know, coming into that Friday, when Judas sold his Lord for 30 pieces of silver, we know, all of us reading the Bible, what was going to happen on Friday. But no one knew on Friday, the disciples, other than Jesus, they did not know what kind of horrible death he was going to die of. In fact, they thought, because once all this puppet type of court will be finished, they would find Jesus innocent. And so did Judas. But when Judas started witnessing how this court just wanted Jesus dead, and they proclaimed him guilty of all these sins and crimes that he didn't commit, Judas felt remorse in his heart. He goes back to the temple, back with his money, his blood money, and he tells the priest, no, listen, you got it wrong. I got it wrong. This man should not die. You remember the words of the priests? It's your responsibility, Judas. and Judas threw the money into the temple, they will not even take that money and put it into their own treasury because it was against their law to use blood money for that. So they went and they bought a potter's field for those people coming out of town that died in Jerusalem, for the foreigners to have a little place, a resting place, and they bought that land with slave money. 30 pieces of silver is the implied price of a slave. That's how much Jesus was worth to his friend. You're only a slave. The Bible says that Judas goes with all that remorse. He finds a tree outside the city. What does he do? He commits suicide. That Friday, only two people died. That Friday, only two people, according to the Bible, died on that Friday. One was the Lamb of God at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, enshrouded in darkness because God did not want the whole world to continue to mock him. The whole world to continue to sneer at him. So God engulfed the Calvary with an incredible darkness of night until the moment right before he died, darkness lifted, everybody saw Christ, and then Jesus exhaled and he said to the Lord, Father, in your hands what?
I commend my spirit.
And he dies. The Lamb of God died that Friday. Judas died that Friday as the symbol of that goat. Where in Leviticus 16, it is a symbol of the devil that all the culpability, every shame, all the things that were wrong, that it was his fault, landed on the head of the devil. Judas represented that goat who died that Friday. While Jesus represented the real Lamb of God. Can you imagine? Millions of people watching this spectacle. People not understanding why this innocent man, you know, is going to be crucified. But they all joined in mocking the Lord. In fact, the Bible says that even the two thieves joined in mocking Christ. As they saw him next to him, you know, they started saying, you're innocent, man. How come you don't save us too? How come you just come out? Or you're a fraud. You're a fraud. You say nothing. In fact, the very first words that Jesus said on that cross was, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing. And when he said those words, one of the thieves looks at him and says, Dear God, this is the real deal. Why are we doing what we're doing to this man? This guy is innocent. Did you know? We are guilty. It is righteous for what the government is doing for us, but it's not because of this man is innocent. And that day, that one man that asked Jesus for forgiveness becomes a representative of us all. Isn't that incredible? That the representative in the flesh for my sins, for understanding forgiveness, was also a criminal that day. And that's why the Bible says, very interesting, that while we were sinners and enemies of God, God gave his son for us. Isn't that good news? That is fantastic news. And that Friday morning, the Bible says that Joseph of Arimathea, and it's interesting how John puts it, or Mark puts it also, he developed somehow some strength because he was a closet Christian. He liked Jesus. He loved what he did, but he did not come out publicly and say, I am a follower of Christ. And as soon as Jesus dies, he runs to Pilate, and he says, hey, I have a burial place. Can I take him, please? Well, Pilate is kind of, you know, hey, what's going on here? How could he die? Nobody dies on the very first day of crucifixion. No one does. What do you mean? So he calls his centurion, the centurion calls somebody else, and the word spreads out, the word comes back, yes, Jesus is dead. So Pilate gives Joseph permission to go and get his body. But according to the Bible, it says that another man, another closet Christian, comes up right next to Joseph. What was his name? Nicodemus. you know, in the background, behind the rock, following this very popular guy, but not popular with their career, they come out of the closet, and the Bible says that Nicodemus brings 75 pounds of perfume, aloes, and myrrh in order.